Good morning. Good morning. I want to welcome each of you to our services here at First Baptist Church today. We welcome those who also are joining us by way of television. It's good to have you here. I hope you got a bulletin as you came in this morning from one of our ushers. Our bulletin has our order of worship as well as a number of announcements, and we'll encourage you to take a look at these as sometime before you leave or once you get home. There are several things coming up in the coming week and weeks, and you need to be aware of that. This coming Friday night, our youth will be having a fifth quarter. We sponsor fifth quarters after all the home football games, and we invite all the area youth to come to the church gym for a time of fellowship. We'll have some food and some gifts to give away, so we'll be back in full swing on Friday night. And if you're an adult who would like to help out with the fifth quarter, I know Andy's always looking for chaperones, and if you can help us, we sure would appreciate it. Please don't forget that next Sunday is our churchwide picnic. We look forward to having a good time over on the campus of LMU, and we hope that you'll join us, and hope you'll invite others to join us to help maybe get to know some people a little bit better as well. I'll let you read the rest, but please make sure and take note of the things that are going on in the coming week. There's always plenty going on here at First Baptist, and I'm very proud of that and thankful for a church that has so much going on. Yesterday, I never did actually get a count. Bill, you know how many? 17 people showed up to help us as we did a service project in the community. We worked on a house, built a handicap ramp, and did some painting, and just had a wonderful time of fellowship, and was able to hopefully do good for our family and the community as well. And I want to thank each of you who participated in that. It did allow us to complete a goal that we established about this time last year, that we would work on four different houses during the course of the year. And I'm very proud of our church's commitment in doing that, and certainly hope that in the coming year that we'll be able to do just as many, if not more. But thanks to all those who did participate yesterday. It was a wonderful experience for everybody involved. As we come to worship this morning, I want to just read a couple of brief passages from Psalm 118. The psalmist says, "This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it." He goes on to say, "The Lord is God, and he has made his light shine upon us. With boughs in hand, join in the festal procession up to the horns of the altar." And then he adds, "You are my God, and I will give you thanks. You are my God, and I will exalt you. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever." With the psalmist today, I want to encourage you to give to the Lord your praise, to give him the honor and the glory that he is so deserving of. This is the day the Lord has made. Let's rejoice and be glad in it.
Let's stand and sing hymn 58, "Like a River Glorious." Please stand.
Thank you. Good morning. Let us pray. Father, we thank thee for the privilege of coming to this wonderful church, and we appreciate all the love that is shown. And we know, our Father, that we are to have no other gods before us but you. And we try to do that. And we know the second one commandment is, we love our neighbor as ourself. And that is a hard thing to do sometimes. And we know that if we can do these two commandments, our Father, the others are not going to be as hard. And we ask that you would be with our church this morning as we worship. Be with our pastor as he brings the message. And let us pray the prayer now that you've taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
At this time, we'll ask the children to come forward for the children's sermon. Good morning, boys and girls. So good to have you in church today. The lesson today for the extended session comes from the Gospel of Luke, and it's about Jesus and about some people he ran across one day as he was traveling. There happened to be 10 men who were lepers. Does anyone know what a leper is?
I don't.
You don't? It's not a leopard. That's an animal that was spots. A leper is someone who has skin disease, and in biblical times, if you had leprosy, or if you were a leper, you had to stay away from everybody else, and nobody could come touch you, nobody could really talk to you except for from a distance, and it was a horrible disease to have. And one day, as Jesus was walking along, these 10 lepers saw Jesus, and they hollered out to him, "Hey, Jesus, would you please help us? Please help us." And so Jesus went up to them and told them what to do. He said he wanted them to go to the priest and show them their skin. And so they went off, and as they were going, the Bible says they were healed. And all of a sudden, all 10 of them were made clean and no longer had leprosy. And that's a wonderful story. It's a wonderful miracle that's recorded in the Bible. But the story goes on to tell us something else. It says that when the 10 men saw that they were healed, that one of them went back to Jesus to say thank you. And it's a very good thing for him to have done, to go back and think, because Jesus did something wonderful for him. But the strange thing, and Jesus even raises the question, you know, weren't 10 healed? Where are the other 9? And it's a very sad thing that 9 of those people were healed by Jesus, but never bothered to go back and say thank you. And in this lesson, we are reminded that when God does things for us, we need to be thankful. We need to make sure that we go to Jesus and say, "Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for giving me another day to live. Thank you for forgiving my sins. Thank you for loving me." I mean, there's lots of things that Jesus does for us day by day, and we need to offer thanks.
But I have a question.
You have a question? Okay, what's your question?
Everybody should love God.
Everybody should love God, and a part of loving God is giving thanks. And I think there's another lesson here for us too, boys and girls, that Jesus felt like it was important to say thank you. And not only do we need to say thank you to God, but we need to say thank you to the people who are nice to us. Do you have people in your lives who are nice to you?
I do.
You do? Okay. Maybe it's a parent, your moms and dads. Maybe it's a brother and sister. Maybe. It could be a teacher. It could be a friend. But here's what I want to do. I'm going to give you a postcard from our church. It has a picture of our church. A beautiful picture. I say that because I took it. But on the back, I've just written a little note. It says, "Thank you for being so nice to me." And I'm going to give each of you this card. And what I want you to do is take this card and give it to somebody who's been nice to you. And it'd be your way of saying thank you to them for being so nice. You might keep it. No, you give it to somebody else. And maybe someone will give you one day. But I want each of you to take this card and give it to somebody who's been nice to you. Here you go, buddy. Want to take it? Nope. Never mind. Okay. Well, let's bow our heads and give thanks to God for being so good to us, okay? Lord, we've been reminded this morning that you are so good to us, and that when you are good to us and you bless us, that you deserve our thanks. And this morning, I want to thank you for being my God, for being my Savior, for being my friend. And I want to thank you for this wonderful church you've given us and for these beautiful children. I have so much to be thankful for. And as I look around the room today, I see so many people to be thankful for because they have been good to me, and I've experienced your love and your forgiveness and your grace through them. And Lord, give us grateful hearts. Help us to always be thankful and not to be bashful about sharing our thanks with others. Help these boys and girls to do that today, but help the rest of us to do it too. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you, guys. And it wouldn't be a bad exercise for the rest of you to find someone to offer thanks to today. Just thanks for being nice to you. Our fellowship hymn this morning is a course that you'll find, actually I think as an insert in your bulletin. It's something we will sing together in a few moments. But before we do that, what we do here at First Baptist is ask our members and regular attenders to stand. It gives us a chance to greet the people around us. And if you happen to be one of our guests today for the first time, we especially welcome you. And we hope that you'll just remain seated for a moment so our ushers can give you a visitor's card, which we would greatly appreciate you filling out and returning later in the offering plate. The pen that they give you, you can keep as a reminder of your visit with us today. I am thankful to say that our pens finally now have the word church spelled right. For several months, we were handing out pens to people that spelled church wrong, and that was very embarrassing. We now have correct pens, but you're welcome to keep those if you're a visitor with us today. But we're glad each of you are here. If you're a member or regular attender, please stand, greet those around you. In a moment, Todd will lead us in singing, "I Love You, Lord, with All My Heart."
Sweet sound. Good morning. This morning we'll be reading Psalm 36, which is on page 552 in your pew Bibles. And that is Psalm 36. Starting with verse 1. An oracle is within my heart concerning the sinfulness of the wicked. There is no fear of God before his eyes, for in his own eyes he flatters himself too much to detect or hate his sin. The words of his mouth are wicked and deceitful. He has ceased to be wise and to do good. Even on his bed he plots evil. He commits himself to a sinful course and does not reject what is wrong. Your love, O Lord, reaches to the heavens, your faithfulness to the skies. Your righteousness is like the mighty mountains, your justice like the great deep. O Lord, you preserve both man and beast. How priceless is your unfailing love, both high and low among men. Find refuge in the shadow of your wings. They feast on the abundance of your house. You give them drink from your river of delights. For with you is a fountain of life. In your light we see light. Continue your love to those who know you, your righteousness to the upright in heart. May the foot of the proud not come against me, nor the hand of the wicked drive me away. See how the evildoers lie fallen, thrown down, not able to rise. Will you please pray with me? Dear Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning asking you to join us here. Actually, Lord, you already have. And for that, we praise you. But we also want to ask you this morning to take over this place completely. I pray that you will come into all of our lives, every individual here, and help us to truly focus on you and whatever it is that you brought us here this morning for. Lord, you have a lesson for each of us. You have a word for each of us. You have something in our lives for every one of us, a blessing you want to give us. And I pray that you will help us to recognize this blessing. Help us to hear your words. We pray that you will just anoint Chuck as he brings the message and anoint our ears to hear your voice, Lord. We are hungry for you and we need you, Lord. We love you and praise you so much. It's in your great name we pray. Amen.
Our offertory hymn is My Jesus, I Love Thee. That's hymn 210. Let's stand and sing together, please.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Father, we thank thee for the privilege of coming to your house and for the many blessings they bestow upon us. And one of these blessings is the privilege of giving. And we give out of love, our Father, because you gave so much to us. And we ask that you would help our church use these tithes and offerings in a way that would be pleasing to thee. This we ask in thy name. Amen.
you, choir. Obviously, school is now back in session, and I don't know that this has ever happened in Middlesboro or happened in Bell County school system, but I did read once about how following the first day of school, each kindergarten child arrived home with a note from the teacher that read, "Dear parents, if you promise not to believe all your child says happens at school, I promise not to believe all that happens at home." Sometimes we don't want to believe everything that we hear. But as we've been reminded the last couple of weeks, as we've looked at Christ's words to the churches in Revelation, it is important what we believe, and we need to know what we believe, and so that we can be careful when false teachings come along. And this turns out to be another issue for the church that we're looking at this morning. I want to ask you to read with me from God's Word today, the book of Revelation, chapter 2, verses 18 through 29. This is Christ's letter to the church at Thyatira. Let's read together God's Word, and as we read, let's also listen to what the Holy Spirit might have to say to us in our own hearts today. "To the angel of the church in Thyatira write, these are the words of the Son of God, whose eyes are like blazing fire and whose feet are like burnished bronze. I know your deeds, your love and faith, your service and perseverance, and that you are now doing more than you did at first. Nevertheless, I have this against you. You tolerate that woman Jezebel, who calls herself a prophetess. By her teaching, she misleads my servants into sexual immorality and the eating of food sacrificed to idols. I have given her time to repent of her immorality, but she is unwilling. So I will cast her on a bed of suffering, and I will make those who commit adultery with her suffer intensely unless they repent of her ways. I will strike her children dead. Then all the churches will know that I am he who searches hearts and minds, and I will repay each of you according to your deeds. Now I say to the rest of you in Thyatira, to you who do not hold to her teaching and have not learned Satan's so-called deep secrets, I will not impose any other burden on you. Only hold on to what you have until I come. To him who overcomes and does my will to the end, I will give authority over the nations. He will rule them with an iron scepter. He will dash them to pieces like pottery, just as I have received authority from my Father. I will also give him the morning star. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches." Once again, it is my prayer that God would add his blessing to both the reading and the hearing of his word. This morning, it is our privilege to look at Christ's fourth letter to the churches of Asia Minor. This one is addressed to the church located in the town of Thyatira. Thyatira, unlike the three previous cities we have looked at, was a relatively unimportant town. Its sole claim to fame was basically its trade. And it is a bit intriguing that the city that actually is the least important of all the seven cities that Christ will address, that this city, this church, receives the longest letter, and by many accounts is the most difficult letter to understand. In verse 18, we discover that the sender of the letter is the Son of God, whose eyes are like blazing fire and whose feet are like burnished bronze. You may find it interesting to know that this is the only time in all the book of Revelation that Jesus is referred to as the Son of God. In all the book, the only time. Now, certainly it is implied elsewhere, but this is the only time it is explicitly said that Jesus is the Son of God. And maybe it is included here in order to emphasize that it is Jesus and not Caesar, as some were saying, who is the one and only true Son of God. The description of Christ as having eyes like blazing fire and feet like burnished bronze is taken right out of the book of Daniel, Daniel chapter 10, verse 6. The flaming eyes here probably stand for a couple of things. First, they are a symbol of God's blazing anger against sin.
We talk a lot these days about the love of God, and it's only right that we do so, but we must never forget that there's also that holy and wrathful side of God, and that because God is love, sin angers him. It disturbs him. It bothers him. And so we see in these blazing eyes God's anger against sin. And then second, they refer to the awful penetration of that gaze, which strips away all disguises and sees into a person's inmost heart. The brazen feet, on the other hand, probably stand for the immovable power of the risen Christ. And the image that is presented here is one of strength and one of splendor. In verse 19, Christ tells the Christians at the church in Thyatira that he knows their deeds. Well, we've seen that in some of the previous letters as well. And he says to this church also, I know your deeds. And he goes on to list four deeds in particular that he had noticed. First and foremost, this he saw love, that their deeds were characterized by love. And combined with this love, there was faith. And this combination of love and faith had resulted in acts of service and perseverance. Love, it would seem, always results in acts of service. That when you have real true love, there will be acts of service as well. And where there is faith, perseverance always has a way of showing up as well. The four things which Christ found to commend the church at Thyatira for are four things that he continues to look for in his churches. All of Christ's churches, including the First Baptist Church of Middlesboro, should be characterized by love, by faith, by service, and by perseverance. Any church which is lacking in these four traits must surely be a disappointment to Christ. But know not only that this church was characterized by these four things, but also that Christ commends them because their deeds of late are greater than at first. Whereas the church at Ephesus was chastised because their love for God and man had waned, this church is praised because they had grown in their service and love for God and one another. And I can't help but believe that there is a significant lesson for us here this morning. It is not enough for the Christian, it is not enough for a church to only maintain their position. Every Christian and every church ought to be seeking to grow, seeking to do more. And this is something that is a problem in the modern church. Many people are quite satisfied with the level of their commitment. Many people kind of grow tired, maybe weary in doing good, and you'll hear them say from time to time, you know, I've done my part. It's time for somebody else to take over. It's time for someone else to do their part. And you hear that kind of talk every year when the nominating committee begins to do their work. You even hear that same kind of talk when you go through the process for deacon elections. And it's sad. It shouldn't happen. We should never get satisfied with our service. We should never think that we have a right to sit back and let someone else do the work. We are all called to serve God. And we are all called to serve our fellow man. And according to the scriptures here, we should be doing more now than we were doing last year. And next year at this time, we ought to be able to look back and say, yes, I'm doing more now than I was then. And I'm convinced there's some of us who need to hear that message today. Despite the fact that this church had grown in service toward God and man, and despite the fact that it was characterized by love, faith, service, and perseverance, Christ found a serious flaw within the church. And that flaw is referred to in verse 20. Christ says, I have this against you, that you tolerate that woman Jezebel. By her teaching, she misleads my servants into sexual immorality and the eating of food sacrificed to idols. As I'm sure you've already noticed, the problem in this church is quite similar to the problem in the church at Pergamum that we looked at last week. They were being tolerant of something that was harmful to the church. And in this particular case, it was a woman named Jezebel. Actually, in reality, this woman's probably name was not actually Jezebel. And it is more likely that this is a derogatory title that was bestowed upon her by Christ. I'm sure many of you are familiar with the Old Testament character Jezebel. She was the wife of King Ahab and was remembered for leading the Israelites to worship Baal and to stray from the true faith in God. And over a period of time, the name Jezebel came to be synonymous with wickedness and with evil. Like the Old Testament Jezebel, this woman that Christ refers to apparently was misleading God's people, was seducing them to sexual immorality, was leading them astray. We really don't know a whole lot about the woman that Christ referred to. We do know that she claimed to be a prophetess. And that means that she was claiming that she could interpret God's will for the church at Thyatira. And the fact that she had not been thrown out of the church would seem to imply that she must have been an influential member, a person of good standing in the church. She may have been someone that everyone in the church absolutely loved and adored, but Christ says that despite her popularity, despite her influence, she is not to be tolerated. And why she is not to be tolerated is explained. First, she was leading many of the members of the church astray. She was apparently very persuasive in her arguments and had convinced many of the church members that her views were the right ones. Next, we see that her persuasiveness had led them to commit acts of immorality and to eat food which had been sacrificed to idols. You may recall that these were the same charges that Christ made against the Nicolaitans in last week's letter. But in Thyatira, the situation may have been a bit different from that at Pergamum. As I mentioned to you a few moments ago, the church at Thyatira, or the community of Thyatira, was known for its trade, for its commerce. And as such, it was dominated both socially and economically by the trade guilds within the community. And it is precisely because of this that this crisis, this problem, developed within the church at Thyatira. These trade guilds were created for more than just business. At their meetings, they would have these huge banquets dedicated to the pagan gods of their community. And on many occasions, before the banquet was over, a full-scale orgy would erupt. Now, the Christians there did not want to participate. But at the same time, not to belong to a trade guild was equivalent to commercial suicide. And many Christians in that day had trouble deciding what to do. And that's where Jezebel came in and created a problem. She suggested that there was no need to cut themselves off from society. There was no need to abstain from the guilds. For Jezebel, there was plenty of room for compromise, especially where money was involved. Apparently, Jezebel belonged to a group similar to the Nicolaitans, who taught that in Christ's death and resurrection, all laws had been done away with. And as a result, they came to teach that Christ, the laws of God could be denounced, and they espoused this philosophy of permissiveness. It was pretty much an anything goes way of life. And to top everything off, they actually believed that they had come to this enlightenment that made them superior to the rest of the church. Well, think about the situation. Since such a compromising belief as that espoused by Jezebel did in fact remove the social and the economic barrier that hindered the Christian, it's not hard at all to see why many of them would have been won over to her side. In such accommodation, one could have their cake and eat it too. Or so they thought. In the verses which follow, Christ reveals that judgment is about to come upon Jezebel and her followers. He knows that she was given the opportunity to repent, but that she was unwilling to do so. Therefore, he was about to cast her upon a bed of suffering and make those who commit adultery with her suffer intentionally, while those who are her children, he says, will be killed. It would seem a distinction is made here between her followers and her children. Children in this case refer to those disciples of Jezebel who had bought wholeheartedly into her way of thinking and to her ethics. while those who commit adultery with her, in contrast, would have been those still struggling with the problem of how to be loyal to Christ on the one hand, and on the other, how to adapt to the local economy and the social pressures and the mores about them. To these people, Christ makes it clear that he cannot tolerate those who do not give him their full and complete devotion. He can't tolerate that. And it's easy to understand why Christ would have a problem with this when we think back about how Christ came and literally gave his all for us. He in turn now expects us to give our all for him. And when we don't, it disturbs him. It angers him. If we compromise our faith, we too can expect God's judgment to come upon us. Now, in the case of Jezebel and her followers, it was sickness, it was suffering. In our case, it may be something totally different. But we can rest assured that God is not going to sit back and watch idly while his children act and behave as though they are not his children. In bringing this judgment upon them, Christ says that all the other churches will see that he is the one who knows everyone's thoughts and everyone's wishes and who repays each person according to his or her deeds. It's interesting to note here that what is actually said in verse 23 is that Christ is the one who searches, listen to this, the kidneys and the hearts of everyone. In biblical times, the kidneys were thought to be the center of one's emotions, while the heart was thought to be the center of one's intellect. Thus, what Christ is saying is he knows everything. He knows everything we feel. He knows everything we think. Jezebel and her followers may have fooled a lot of people, having convinced them that they were fine, outstanding Christians. But Christ makes it clear here that he cannot be fooled. Unfortunately, there are a lot of people today who are still guilty of doing some of the same. A lot of Christians who put on a good disguise. But Christ says here, I know better. And let's be honest, it is one of the easiest things in the world to fool people about this. If you want people to think you're a good, fine, upstanding Christian, what do you have to do? Just show up at church on Sunday morning, and that's about it. It's easy for you to fool other people. It's easy for me to fool other people. But Christ reminds us here, he cannot be fooled. Christ knows next that we will be rewarded one day, not according to the show we put on, but rather according to our deeds. We really must learn here that God does expect something from us. As Baptists, we have spent so much time denying that one can be saved by works that we have failed to emphasize the importance of works in God's kingdom. No, we are not saved by works. Paul made that very clear in Ephesians 2. He says, we are not saved by works. We're saved by grace through faith, not by works, lest any man should boast. But he goes on in two verses later to say, we're not saved by works, but we are saved for works. Works are a very important part of the Christian life. In fact, if you're a Christian, it means you're one who does good deeds. One who does good deeds for his or her Lord. To those who have remained faithful to him, to those who had not been seduced by Jezebel, Christ says in our passage that he will not place any other burden upon them. And it sounds a little strange, but here reference is probably being made to the directive that was handed down by the Jerusalem Council recorded in Acts 15 that Gentile converts would not be required to make any major changes other than they would be required to abstain from eating food that had been offered as a sacrifice to idols and to also abstain from sexual immorality. And perhaps Jesus is saying here to this church, we're not going to add any more burdens to you except that of holding fast to that which you already have. And maybe here he's going back again to those deeds he saw earlier and say, what I want you to do is hold on to that love. I want you to hold on to that faith, that service, that perseverance. It's really important that you hold fast to that and not give up, that you keep on doing better, keep on serving me. He calls for them to remain faithful until he returns.
And to the one who does remain faithful, to the one who overcomes, once more Christ offers a promise. He promises that the faithful ones will be given authority over the nations and that they shall rule them with an iron scepter. And undoubtedly, the background of this passage is Psalm 2. If you go back and look at Psalm 2, that we find the king who is the divine son being promised the nations as his inheritance and that he will shatter all opposition with them. So what we discover here is that the conqueror, the one who is faithful to Christ, has likewise promised authority over the nations and the power to crush the opposing forces of paganism and all resistance to the will of God. I don't fully understand it, but Christians, it would appear, are to share one day in Christ's messianic rule over the nations. It's pretty exciting stuff, wouldn't you say? A further promise was given to the faithful Christian is the bestowal of the morning star. And today's scholars are quite uncertain as to exactly what is meant by this promise of the morning star. Some have pointed out that the morning star is Venus, and Venus for a long time has been a symbol of sovereignty, the conquest and rule over the nations. And if that's what the reference is to, it's just a follow-up to what has just been said. Others have noted that the morning star is a symbol of hope. Every morning you get up and you see the morning star, you know that a new day is dawning. And perhaps here Christ is offering the faithful, the one who endures to the end, hope for a better day to come. But there is still yet another option open for us. If you turn to the very last chapter of the book of Revelation, you will see that Christ describes himself as the bright morning star. It would seem, therefore, best to see here a promise from Christ that when life comes to an end, if a Christian has remained faithful and true to him, that person will possess Christ, never to lose him again. To the one who remains faithful, a sweet fellowship with Jesus is promised, a fellowship that will last into all eternity. Now, I do believe it is important that you note here that these promises are specifically for those who keep Christ's deeds until the end. And what this reminds us of is the fact that the Christian life is not so much a single battle as it is a campaign. It lasts as long as we live, and this is where a lot of us miss out. We think that all we have to do is come and join the church and get baptized and everything's fine and that we've done everything we ever need to do, and that's not true. It's just the start of a long journey, of a long battle, a long war that does not conclude until the day we take our last breath. Christ ends his letter with the haunting words we've heard before. He says one more time, "He who has ears to hear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches." And this call to listen certainly involves far more than just hearing with one's ears. It's almost as though Christ is saying here, having heard what you have, do something about it. It's a call to action. And I want to say the same thing to you this morning. Having heard what you have heard today, what will you do about it? Will you too seek to live a life which is characterized by love and faith, by service and perseverance? Will you strive with everything you've got to do more and more for Christ your Lord, who gave his all to you? Will you make sure not to compromise your faith for financial gain? Will you remain faithful and loyal to Christ until the very end? Having heard Christ's words to you this morning, what will you do? Let's pray. Lord Jesus, I thank you for the letters that we have recorded that you sent so long ago to the churches of Asia Minor. And even though they were sent long ago to people far, far away, we cannot help but believe, having looked at them, that they are letters that have been sent to us here today as well. And I thank you for the letter we've had a chance to look at this morning. I'm not exactly sure what you would say if you wanted to say to us today that you've seen our deeds. I would like to think you would say the same thing, that you have seen in us love and faith, service and perseverance. And Lord, if that's not the case,
we would seek forgiveness and ask that you would help us to get our focus back where it should be. Again, I'm not sure if you would say to us what you said to this church, that we are serving you more than we have in the past. I'm afraid in a lot of our lives, our commitment has waned instead of grown stronger. We're not as committed, we're not as faithful as we once were. And Lord, where that is the case, we would again seek your forgiveness and ask you to help us to do better, that you'd give us another chance so that we can prove our love to you. And Lord, I know that it is, especially in the world we live in, it's easy to compromise our faith. And perhaps some of us have done that so that we could make financial gain. And maybe there's even someone here today who's being tempted to do that now, to compromise their principles just to make another buck. And Lord, remind us again today, it's not worth it, that the most important thing is staying faithful to you. And I pray that that is what will happen for everybody in this room, every person watching this program, that we will remain faithful and loyal to you until the very end. Lord, please help us. We know that we still have a way to go. We know that the journey's not over. The campaign continues. Help us to be faithful. I know in the past all of us have promised that we would. I'm just not so sure we've always kept our promises. But today, we're going to try again. We're going to promise you anew that we'll do better, that we will serve you to the end, that we will be faithful and true. And we know that with your help, that is indeed possible, and that gives us hope. Lord, during this invitation, I pray that your spirit would move, and I would pray that your will be done. There are people who need to give their hearts to you, get right with you. I pray that they would do so here and now. And there are people who need to make a new commitment to say that I haven't done as much as I should and I need to do more. I pray they will come today making that commitment. And then if there are those who need to join this church and get involved in a church that takes seriously the mission you've called us to fulfill, I pray that you would give them the courage to come today as well. Our prayer first and foremost is your will be done in each individual life, but also in our church as a body too. All this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Our hymn of invitation this morning is 276, O Jesus, I Have Promised. And we all have made promises to him, but how faithful have we been in keeping them? Today we have a chance to make those promises all over again. And I hope you'll take advantage of this opportunity, and I hope that you'll listen to God's Spirit speaking to your heart, or maybe it's your kidney, I don't know. But as he speaks to you today, listen and respond as he leads you. having been reminded this morning just how seriously God does take sin, it is my prayer that you may be shielded from sin in the week to come, that you would be strong in times of trial and temptation, that you will live lives that honor God and bring glory to his kingdom. It is important as we leave that we have our assignment, and our assignment is what we sing, to trust and obey. 447, verse 1.